We are interested in knowing in history.
Okay, sir. Sir, I would like to know whether the patient is having on and off fever since how many days? Any Correct. Previous history of fever?
Right.
Any history of voiding complaints? Any history of frequency, urgency?
No, first you finish about fever. See, that is why when you are giving the presentation, finish off everything and then go to the no history of this.
Okay,
so
sir.
Fever, you are right. What else you want to ask about fever? This is a
I would like to ask the type of fever he is having, whether he is having high grade fever, low grade fever, since how many days he is having fever, whether he has received any medications for this fever.
Okay, very good.
Whether he the medications which has received after that, whether the fever was relieved, the pain was relieved or not, sir.
Correct. So here what you are interested in, how much is the severity of the fever, whether it is a high grade or just low grade fever, whether it is coming with rigors or not. So that is very important, because if fever is just coming and without rigors and with rigors, there is a difference in understanding.
Yeah.
Okay, so these details, whether it is relieved by the medication or not, whether he has started any medication or not. So that is very important to understand during the for detail of fever. Now, tell me, what about the occasional left flank pain since 1 year? Venkat, you tell me this.
Yes, sir. I would like to know the nature of pain, sir. Is it a colicky pain or is it a dull aching pain? And
Correct.
What are the nature of the pain and what did he do about regarding the pain? Did he start any medication or it was relieved on its own? Did it affect his daily routine activity? And so what was done during this one, during this course? And is that flank pain associated with any history of passage of blood clot or any lithuria or any intervention, sir, during this course?
Okay.
Any history of...
Any history of...
Any lump associated on the same side, did he feel or noticed by any other consultation or any nausea, vomitings? And so I would like to know these all histories, sir.
Correct. Okay. So when you have a flank pain, first and foremost is that whether there is any radiation or migration of pain or not. So that will give you a clue what sort of pain it is. Because if it is radiating downwards, you know that it is either renal or uretric colic and there is a... radiation downwards.
Yes.
Type of pain is very important. Colicky pain versus dull aching pain versus throbbing pain. There are different factors for that. And then very important is that how this pain is getting aggravated and how it is getting relieved. Because sometimes patient will give typical history that on excessive intake of water, he gets a lot of pain. And pain is relieved by either passing a lot of urine. So you know that it is probably the Dettles crisis. So there is something in the history you can always try to find out whether the pain is relieved by any analgesics or not. How is the frequency of pain? So all these details are necessary to know when you have the history of flank pain or for that matter pain anywhere. So here the fever is intermittent. It is there for last 2 to 3 weeks. It comes with last for 4 to 6 hours. It is with fever and rigors. There is a vomiting along with that. He requires antipyretic to subside. Few episodes of dysuria, occasional turbid urine, no LUTS, hematuria, lithuria, no other recurrent fever in the past. Okay. Then the left flank pain is off and on for last 1 year. Not really a definitive frequency. Sometimes it comes, sometimes it goes. It is of a low intensity. It is dull aching in nature, non-radiating, no aggravating or relieving factors. No LUTS or fever in the past and urinary symptoms with the flank pain. No history of trauma, no history of flank trauma, no fullness of flank, no history of frequent analgesics intake. Okay. So, what else negative history you will ask for? Krishnendu, what else you will ask?
In the negative history, I will take history whether the patient has any decreased appetite, any loss of weight, any feature suggestive of pedal edema or facial puffiness, any breathlessness.
Now you want to ask about the anorexia, loss of weight, and vomiting? What is the
because, case? Sir, in the both the histories, most of the negative findings echo. Has been already written. There is no
echo. Yeah. Okay. So, what else you will ask for?
Sir, most of the negative histories already has been taken. No LUTS, right. No hematuria, no lithuria, no heaviness or flank tenderness. So what left is in my differential diagnosis, I have to see whether
Wait. Differential diagnosis is still far off. There is no history of facial puffiness, edema, feet. Is that not important?
Yes, sir. That is very important. The reason is that facial puffiness, pedal edema, shortness of breath, this suggests that probably the patient is having renal insufficiency.
So whenever patient has any flank pain, especially if it is for long time, it is good idea to ask all this history. There may be present, it may not be present. History of decreased urine output, that also is important.
Yes.
Why? Because he has got fever, he has got pain, and you don't know whether it is a solitary kidney, if there is any other factor which is present, which can, if the patient says, no, I had actually good output, but last few days I have noticed that output is less. Immediately, you know what exactly is the problem which is happening. So this patient has weight loss, according to him, for last 1 month, he is feeling anorexia, vomiting, and there is a weight loss, history of loss of appetite for last 1 month. But no history of jaundice, hemoptysis, bone pain, and bowel habits are normal. Okay, so in this past history is very significant that he has undergone bilateral renal stone surgery 17 years back, and he has got both sides PCNL supposedly was done. The details are not available, but whatever patient is saying that one by one the surgery was done, and he went for follow-up twice, and after that he stopped going for follow-up. Now, Vaibhav, you tell me that when patient gives such history that he has undergone some stone surgery, he has no details, there are no papers. So, what do you infer from such thing, or anything else you want to ask?
Sir, I'd like to ask the history whether the 17 years back when he underwent a surgery, whether it was an open surgery or then was a minimal access surgery done.
Right. So bilateral minimal access surgery was done, both sides. And what he has written is that right was done first and left was done later. So what else you want to know?
Then I would like to ask him, how was the course of his admission after the surgery? Whether he had any history of fever, whether he had any history of prolonged tube to be kept, whether any DJ stent was kept or not, whether any PCN tube was kept or not.
Good. Okay. What else?
Whether he had any history of fever post-op, whether he was informed regarding the complete clearance of the stone or not.
Right. I think that's very, very important. Whether any investigations were done to check whether the stones have completely removed or not. Quite often patient will say, no, that was not checked. And I was told that everything is fine. So that is very important. What else is very important?
Sir, history of DJ stent, whether it was kept or not.
Correct. So here there was no stent kept.
No stent.
Yeah. What else?
Whether he was called up for the follow up and how was he follow up? What all?
He was called for follow up regularly, but he went only twice and after that he stopped.
Okay. Whether he was advised any lifestyle changing habits to be followed?
Not so important. Now, what is important from your point of view when you have such case in the exam as to what exactly was done? Because patient is going to tell very limited things. There are no papers. So, what you want to extract from patient as, and that will tell you what exactly happened in that surgery. So, you have told very correctly whether the tubes were kept or not, stent was kept or not, how long he stayed in the hospital, then whether there was any fever post-op or not. All those things you have told. Anything else you want to ask, which is very important, about the history of so-called stone surgery done?
Requirement of blood transfusion.
Yes, correct. So blood transfusion, whether he has received any blood transfusion or not, that patient will definitely know And in fact, they will always remember that one bottle was given or two bottles were given. So that actually implies as to what sort of a problem, whether there was any problem post-op or intra-op or not. What else is very important which patient will never forget?
Any staged procedure or multiple punctures and that?
No, multiple punctures, how patient will know?
How long the multiple scars present over the back, sir?
No, that examination is different. This is the history what we are talking.
How long the catheter was kept and how long the PCN tube was kept?
Yeah, okay. But more than that.
And any, what was the color of the
fluid? Discharge from the PCN site?
Okay, so all that thing is okay, but very, very important is that what was the duration of surgery? Apart from all these things what you have told, which is correct, but apart from that, if patient says, no, actually the operation was finished in half an hour, and one patient says, no, operation actually lasted for 4 hours, then you know that there were a problem. Patient may not have received any transfusion, but very fact that the operation lasted for quite a long time itself gives you a clue that there must be some intraoperative problem. Luckily, there were no post-op problem, but intraoperatively, there must be some problem. So when you are investigating, that gives a very nice clue as to in which direction you are going to investigate, and whatever investigation the results come, what are you going to take the implications from that, okay? So that's very important. This is true for any surgery. Whenever there is a history of previous surgery, whether it is PCNL, whether it is open surgery, whether it is for stone, whether it is for anything, these are the things which are important. How long he stayed, post-operative event, duration of surgery, blood transfusion, what were complaints before, why he went, what was the problem at that time, whether it was immediate emergency surgery, whether it was a staged procedure, whether it was an elective surgery. So this will give you a clue as to what actually went wrong at that time. Okay, so this is the history here. The next is that family history. There is a family history of stone disease, but otherwise there is no other problem. Do you attach any importance to this? Sister had history of renal stone and she was operated.
Yes, sir.
Venkat?
Yes, sir. Stones like cysteine, xanthine, uric acid, they have family history, sir, which is significant. So we might get a hint towards the metabolic evaluation and further subsequent treatment course on IDEA regarding the family history. So,
so if there is any family history, it is possible that this may have some metabolic cause. As you know that in renal stone in our country, it is endemic. Many times, more than 50 or more than 60% times, even if you do thorough metabolic evaluation, you will not find any abnormality because these are all environmental factors which are the etiological factors for the stone. But if patient says that, oh, now my mother had this problem, my sister had this problem, so definitely you need to take the note of that. And then later on, you may think of doing a metabolic evaluation to find out if there is any familial cause, if there is any problem or not. Right. I think that's very, very important. The personal history, of course, here you can ask for the diet and other things which are okay. That's not all that this. Any previous treatment, any past visit to the physician and all is a routine thing. Okay. So this is all in our examination. Now, in a case like this, now tell me, Weber,
yes.
In a case like this, with this history of finish, now what is your goal of examination of this patient? What are the things which you want to see?
Sir, from history point of view, sir?
Yes, no, examination. Now, what are the things you want to examine?
Okay, sir. I'd like to examine his vitals, sir.
Okay, so that's okay.
Okay. I'd like to see if patient is having any pedal edema, any facial edema, the patient is having any anemia. Patient is having... Yes, sir. Hello?
Yes, go ahead.
If patient is having any anemia, I'd like to examine his abdomen. Okay. I'd like to examine whether any flank tenderness is there or not. Any rhinomegaly is there or not. Thereafter, I'd like to do a suprapubic examination just
so
to
basically
see
you want to see whether there is any tenderness in the renal angle, whether bladder is palpable, whether there is any lump or not, and yeah. general examination about the puffiness of face, edema, feet, and BP and other things. Okay.
Yes.
All right. I think you are right. So in this patient, everything was quite okay. There was not much pallor. BMI is okay. On the back, there are marks of the previous PCNL. Single mark on either side, so probably just one puncture. And scrotum, everything is fine. DRE normal. Basically, nothing much. All right.
Yeah.
So now, how will you proceed? Prashandu, how will you proceed?
Sir, at this point of time, I would like to do some investigations. First,
yes.
do complete blood count, creatinine, blood sugar.
So before you go for the investigation, now you have taken this case, history is over, examination is over. Tell me in order of preference, what is your differential diagnosis?
Sir, my first differential diagnosis is left side stone with left side renal stone with infection, left side pyelonephritis, left side uteric stricture with pyelonephrosis, left side huge obstruction, pyelonephrosis.
Why are you saying every time pyelonephrosis?
Because the patient is having history of fever history of 2 to 3 weeks of repeated fever with flank pain persisting for a period of about 1 year on and off. So it suggests that probably the process is not acute. It is a chronic process. And the very fact the patient is also having 1 or 2 episodes of dysuria. And
yes, but that does not mean that necessarily that it is always pyelonephritis.
It
right,
may be pyelonephritis as well.
It could be pyelonephritis.
Yes.
See, now yes. You have to correlate all the things. You see, when you are giving DD, you have to see history, you have to see examination. Examination, there was no lump palpable. There was no tenderness in the renal angle. There is no fullness in the renal angle. So when you are seeing this, history of fever, but on examination, all this is normal, the examiner will not like it. You see, you have to see everything. So you say that, okay, there is a likelihood of pyelonephritis. It could be, nobody can diagnose on the examination, but these are the factors in favor. So stone with renal infection. Okay.
Stone
what else is your diagnosis?
The stone, as I have said already, pyelonephritis, maybe
yes.
UJ with infection.
UJ with infection. What sort
yes.
of UJ you are thinking of?
Sir, I am thinking because of the past history of PCNL already done. So it
yeah.
may be a PUJ with superadded infection.
Are you talking about primary PUJ or secondary PUJ?
Secondary PUJ, sir. Secondary
PUJ. PUJ. Why not primary PUJ?
Sir, primary PUJ, by this time, it is very unlikely that at the age of 45, also the patient already having a history of stone disease, PCNL done. Primary
PUJ. So many patients come at 45 years with PUJ obstruction. Don't you diagnose PUJ obstruction in 40 years of age? You can. So what is preventing? Somebody must have done he must have got a secondary stone and somebody has just removed the stone.
Okay,
it's possible. So it could be PUJ obstruction, which either could be primary, it could be secondary. Anything
yes.
is possible.
Yes.
But what when you are asked about this, what is additional thing which you have to tell? Now then it will impress the examiner.
Sir, it may be a renal abscess or perinephric abscess.
No. When we are discussing the PUJ, that is point I want to derive. You have to think of everything. Now you have taken examination, you have taken history, you have done examination. See, the point in favor, point against the primary PUJ is that in the history you specifically ask there is no stent kept. Okay. Now, if there was a primary PUJ with stone at that time, and if the stent was not kept, very likely that he would have had the persistent
leak.
Of PCN leak and things like that. And if that time surgeon had thought of this, he would have kept a stent. So if you give that answer, that sir, there was no stent kept and PCNL was done. So my likely diagnosis is secondary PUJ. Immediately examiner gets impressed that yes, this boy has thought of everything. So this is how you link everything. from the history and examination, right? Okay.
Yes.
What else? What else?
Sir, it can be an renal abscess or peritonitic abscess.
Okay.
It can be an ureteric stricture with the pyelonephritis.
Okay, ureteric stricture. Okay, what else?
It can be an cystic disease with infection within the cyst.
Okay. What else? Anything else you want to add? Venkat, Vaibhav, you want to add anything?
Sir, tuberculosis of the
kidney. Renal malignancy.
Tuberculosis, sir.
UTB, sir.
Tuberculosis.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, Vaibhav, you agree with him that he is saying tuberculosis? Why
yes,
you agree with him? Why do you agree with him?
Yes, sir.
Why you agree with him?
Because, sir, GUTB is very common disease that happen in our society, sir.
Okay.
So, we haven't ruled out any history of his contact with GUTB or any previous history of GUTB.
Right.
Or it could be a recent history of TB which he could have succumbed to, sir.
Correct. So in our country, yes. So in our country, whenever patient has a left flank pain, especially of a long duration, comes with fever and anorexia, vomiting and all those things, the GUTB remains one of the differential diagnosis. In our India, that is part and parcel of your diagnosis because we see those patients so often. All right. So I think this covers most of the differential diagnosis. So Krishan, do go ahead. So how will you investigate?
Sir, at first I will do blood investigation, CBC, creatinine, blood sugar, electrolytes, considering the repeated history of vomiting and fever,
okay,
urine routine, and...
One second. Just don't go on. I'm giving you one by one. Don't jump. So his hemoglobin is 9.8. Total count is 10,000. Creatinine is 9.54. Potassium is 4.48. Micarb is 17. Urine is filled back with pus cells. And occasional RBC is culture is showing E. coli. Okay. So now what next?
Next, sir, I would like to do a sonography USG KUB. And extra KUB both.
Okay.
Because there is a past history of stone disease, although the patient is quite comfortably saying there is no stent, sometimes patient can miss. So long standing stent and retained stone or new stone formation is common. So extra KUB as well as...
Okay, so you want ultrasonography and KUB. Okay. So Venkat, do you agree with him?
No, sir. I would have done a bloodless analysis with NCCT KUB, considering the high creatinine and decreased serum bicarbonate. So those two are the first priority with a PT FDT INR, considering coagulopathy. I would like to do these three things, sir, first, other than X-ray and ultrasound.
So you don't want to do ultrasonography, you straight away want to do NCCT.
Yes, sir. Because
okay,
I would have better anatomical picture of the kidney with thyroid nephrosis. I could appreciate the ureter and also bladder and the stone morphology. And I could intervene as and when. And it is a 5-minute investigation. I could see as subjectively rather than objective evidence, sir. So I would go for these three investigations compared to X-ray and ultrasound, sir.
All right. Okay. So, Vaibhav, you agree that you will not do any ultrasound, you will not do any X-ray, you will straight away go for the NCCP.
Sir, I would like to do an UAG first, sir, for this patient. I would like to see these kidneys, his parenchyma, any hydronephrosis, as the patient's creat is high. And if I plan to plan for a stabilization of patient with an PCN for this patient or a DJ stenting, it would be very handy for me to get some additional information with UAG, sir.
Okay. But all this information, what you want, what he's saying is that can be obtained from the NCCT. So why you want to do a double investigation? Whether there is any hydronephrosis or not, whether there is any thing. So all that can be obtained with NCCT also.
Usually we'll be having a UAG machine with us in the OP. So I'd like to get an general idea of what's actually going on with his kidneys, sir. That's why I'd like
to. So I think the answer in the exam is not the NCCT. From the exam point of view, whenever you have this investigation, blood and urine is with you, you have to go in the stepwise manner. That doesn't mean that everything one by one. This patient has a very high creatinine, but he is relatively stable from the history what you found out. At the same time, ultrasonography is a very handy thing. You know, it is not something where it is such an investigation where you have to send the patient somewhere. It is there in your hand. And with ultrasonography, you get lots of information. Suppose this patient was breathless. He has got a lot of this. His mica was less than 10. His potassium was 6. Then obviously, you just do sonography in your own OPD. And then straight away, you send for to the nephrologist for further NCCT. You can delay. Because NCCT, you have to wheel in to the radiology department. There is rush there. Then they will come out. So here, once you do sonography, which is very handy, which is very non-invasive, you get a lot of idea what you are going to get from NCCT apart from the finer details. And it is much quicker, much less expensive and very handy. So I think I will agree with other two that sonography is the one which I will prefer. X-ray KUB is a debatable thing. Nobody is going to quarrel with you why you asked for the X-ray, why you are not asked for the X-ray. But ultrasonography, certainly we would like you to mention ultrasonography, right? So that's the reason which you have to tell. Okay, in this patient, the ultrasonography was done. Right kidney was 8.5 by 3.5 centimeters. No hydrourethra. Stone is seen in the lower calyx, which is 1 centimeter in size. No hydrourethra, no hydronephrosis. Left side, moderate to gross hydronephrosis. Variable thickness of parenchyma. Irregular in outline. The whole kidney is very irregular. And there is a 3 centimeter pelvic stone in the left kidney. Bilateral ureters are not visualized. Urinary bladder is normal, partially distended. Prostate is 12 grams. All right. So now, with this, what do you want to do?
Sir,
okay, I will give you the NCCT also. That NCCT was done. NCCT showed that right side is confirmed, that it was a small kidney on the right side. There is a lower calyceal stone, about 8.5 centimeter, and there is a significant stone. And you can see here that kidney is variable thickness. Here it is quite scarred at this, but here there is a significant hydronephrosis. Middle pole, the parenchyma is a little better. And this is the NCCT report, that right kidney is 8.5 by 3, variable thickness of parenchyma. The lower calyx stone, 1 centimeter, it is 900 HU. And on left side, it is 9.8 by 3.5, thin parenchyma, moderate hydronephrosis. Stone is 2.8 by 1.3 centimeter, 1000 HU. And there's another calyx, lower calyx stone, 7 millimeter, and bladder is empty. Okay. So are you happy now? What next you want to do?
Sir, at this point of time, I would like to contact with the nephrologist. The patient is stable, as we have seen clinically. But creatinine is 9. We are sure at this point of time, if I will discuss whether the patient needs further evaluation in the form of arterial blood gas oxygen, blood gas analysis, and any need of any hemodialysis, which I will discuss. And once and also the coagulation profile of the patient, considering high creatinine in this patient.
Okay, all right. So, Vaibhav, you agree with that plan?
Sir, here mainly the problem seems to be urological, sir, because okay, the stone itself is causing obstruction in the left kidney, which is causing gross hydronephrosis, with the left kidney is quite small. So, I'd like to, okay, I partially agree with Krishnendu that I'd like to do blood gas analysis and PTINR, but I'd like I'll prefer to go with an putting an PCN for this patient and stabilizing this patient, sir.
PCN and
for the creat to stabilize.
Okay. Vaibhav, Venkat, you agree?
Sir, I will agree with Krishnanandu in the is, I won't go and straight away do PCNSAR because patient is having high creatinine with a thin PT. He might bleed drastically by keeping a PCN without any coagulation profile and taking the help of nephrologist to stabilize him. So I would always do the things what Krishnanandu do, and then these are the planning for doing a diversion like degestant initially. If only failed, then PCNSAR. That's what I think.
So in exam, when this sort of a situation comes in, what is the safe answer is that I would like to do diversion in this patient. However, I would also like to ask the nephrologist about the to make sure that he will tolerate the procedure, whichever procedure you do, whether it is PCN, DJ, that we'll discuss later on. But whether he is in a condition to be taken up for any procedure straight or not, because they might want to do the other investigation, they might do ECG, they may want to stabilize from their point of view, but it is always safe answer that I will involve nephrologist, understand from them whether he can tolerate the procedure under local anesthesia or not, and then accordingly I will go ahead. So I think that's a very safe answer, and I agree that in this, when the creatinine is so high, it's also a good idea to do prothrombin time to find out if there is any problem or not. So next thing is that you want to do diversion, right?
Yes,
so
sir.
Diversion, I think, is quite all of you agree. Now, Krishnendu and Vaibhav, they are in favor
yes,
of
sir.
PCN.
But sir, I will not do digestion.
Krishnendu, you want to divert by which PCN, not what by DJ?
No, sir. I don't want to put digestion in this patient. On the left side, there is a gross hydronephrosis. It is likely that the possibility that it may be pus. So I would like to put such a drainage system where there will be a wide bore drainage system. A PCN would provide a wider bore, number one. Number two, PCN can be done under local anesthesia as well. For digestenting of a patient, it will require some anesthesia. Number three, if I put a PCN, then I can find out what is output from their side, because considering the contour of parenchyma, the parenchyma is very thin. It is likely that it may not be a good functioning kidney. And in future, there is a stone, so we can go through the track to remove the stone as well. So putting a PCN will provide us a number of advantage rather than putting a digestate.
Okay, so you have put your reasons. You have put your reasons for PCN. So, Venkat, you tell me why you would like to prefer the digestant in this case.
Sir, why I would like to keep digestant is because the patient is having high creatinine. He might have a deranged coagulation profile. And thirdly, I have no clear evidence that he is having a pyonephrosis inside
right.
with any flutters
right.
mentioned in ultrasound. And
right.
I will always keep a periurethral catheter after digestenting to monitor the urine output for the post-obstructive diuresis or whatever. And mm-hmm. in future, sir, his nadir creatinine might reach only 6 or he might reach 2. So if it gets a nadir creatinine, we can always go and do the PCNL for PCN. But if it doesn't get nadir in young age, I would ask him for the RRT options or pre-transplant nephrectomy rather than PCNL. So DJ is an option, but I can always prefer PCN. If not at all, DJ is possible.
Right. So I think this controversy will always remain, whether in a situation like this, whether to do digestenting or PCN, whatever answer you tell, you need to justify in exam. Whether you prefer digestent, you have to justify. And obviously, examiner is going to tell exactly opposite. So the reason what Krishnendu has said, I think they are very much valid. PCN can be justified for all the reasons what you have mentioned. Now, digestion reason what you have mentioned is also valid. But if you have to talk, suppose the examiner asks you, what are the specific problems of digestion in this patient? What problems you are going to encounter? First and foremost, that digestion purely under local anesthesia is little uncomfortable to the patient. So you have to give some sort of sedation, especially in a male patient. In a female patient, it is all right. So that is one aspect which you need to consider. Secondly, because this stone is of a 3 centimeter size, irregular parenchyma, you are not sure whether it will go or not, the digestion will go or not. And if it doesn't go, if the dye is not going, if the DJ is not going, then ultimately you are going to land up with the PCN. So that is one factor. And as Krishnendu highlighted, in prison, suppose he has got a fever for last 3 weeks, although there is no conclusive evidence that there is no pyonephrosis, but you also have to keep that idea, that option in mind, that they could be infected, infected or turbid fluid or infected fluid inside, which may drain well with the PCN rather than digestion. However, there is no foolproof answer for that. And these are the things how you can defend your answer. All right.
Okay.
Okay. So for this patient, he received 2 sessions of hemodialysis and then he was taken up for PCN. Now, Vaibhav, he's now stabilized, nephrologists have cleared him. And they said, okay, now you go ahead with PCN. Now describe the PCN in this patient. Tell all salient features when you are doing PCN in such a case.
Okay, sir. So as this patient's UHG said, this patient had a left gross hydronephrosis. I'd like to proceed with a left UHG guided PCN for this patient, sir.
Right. Okay. So ultrasound guide, that is one. What else?
Yeah. So in this case, I'd like to do an UHG and I'd like to get a puncture with a small spinal needle. And once the spinal needle is inside the PCS system, I'd like to take some urine for culture and sensitivity.
Why you want to use spinal needle? Why not when you are doing UHG guide, why not use PCN needle? Why spinal needle?
Yeah.
What is the spinal which is going to do? It's a what we use is a PCN needle. Why you are saying that spinal needle? Forget spinal needle. PCN needle is of which size?
So, what we use is 18.
Correct. So 18 French PCN needle. Spinal needle is never 18 French.
Yes.
Oh, sorry, 18 gauge.
18 gauge.
It is a small needle. So use PCN. Don't be afraid. It's a PCN. So you are doing PCN under sonography control. So it's an 18 gauge needle. Okay. So what else you want to tell?
I'd like to take an urine culture before putting the dye study.
Okay.
So so thereafter taking the urine for urine culture sensitivity, I'll like to introduce dye into the PCS system. I'd like to see.
They are punctured. And under ultrasonography, and it's a grossly turbid urine. It's not a frank pus, but it's a grossly turbid urine which has come in. So what next? You have said taken it for culture. So what next you want
Next, I would like to introduce some dye, sir, for fluoroscopic puncture, sir.
Why you want to do that?
Because I'm more comfortable with the fluoroscopic puncture. That's why, sir.
No, but you already punctured the kidney, that the already fluid has come,
sir.
Already taken for culture. So why you want to put dye, remove this and make fresh puncture?
It will give some anatomical information regarding the system. And even with dye study, with slow mixing of dye, I'd like to get information whether this system is having any pus or not, sir.
If the fluid has come, which is turbid, what else you want to know whether there is any pus or not? So I think this answer is not acceptable.
Okay.
Sir. Now, what are the, Venkat, you tell me, what are the flaws in this answer? I'm telling you this answer is not acceptable to the examiner. So you tell me why it is not acceptable to the examiner.
Sir, once we already punctured the system and we aspirated, I would go with the same track rather than keeping a second puncture. Won't.
That is one point. Second point.
And in view of the turbidity and purulent discharge, I won't push anything through the PCN site. Rather than I would dilate and keep the tube. I won't push something.
Why you don't want to push? Why you don't want to push contrast?
Because there is a turbid material, or patient might land up into sepsis because of the pylovenous and pylosinus backflow by pushing something into the blocked kidney rather than aspirating, sir. So, I won't like to push the contrast and see the fluoroscopy, sir. I am comfortable with the ultrasound guidance.
All right. So that is second point. Third point.
Third point, I will look for any bloody discharge because of rapid decompression. So
no, that's okay. What points he has made? See, only for only that. We are discussing only what steps he has said.
Yes, sir. So one is no second puncture, and second is no pushing of contrast. These two I will be taking care of.
So, I think you have understood that pushing the contrast at this point, especially when there is a turbid fluid or pus, is not acceptable because of the reasons what he has mentioned. There are two things. One is that whenever there is a pus, moment you put contrast, it is not going to get mixed up freely in the pelvic alveolar system, and in any case, you are not going to get any details of pelvic alveolar system in presence of pus. That is one. Secondly, when there is a pus, it is a fluid which is present, pus which is present, and if you inject the contrast from outside, then that will further distend the system, and as you rightly pointed out, it will have the pyelovenous and patient can land up with the bacteremia and pyemia. So that is not required. Thirdly, at this juncture, when patient has come with 9 creatinine and other things, you are not interested in delineating the system and find out what we are going to do subsequently. You have a lot of time. At present, your objective is only to decrease and make sure this creatinine comes down. So other things you are not interested. So don't be in the hurry that subsequently it will help me for doing the PCNL, then I will do this way and that way. So that is not required. Even if it is a little bit wrong puncture, doesn't matter. So far as it is not bleeding, your idea is just get into the system and put a tube. All right. So that is very clear. Okay.
Yes.
All right. So in this patient, you want to do PCN. And when you are doing PCN, Vaibhav, coming back to you.
Yes, sir.
At what other things you want to notice when you are doing PCN? One is that you have withdrawn the fluid, which is turbid. Anything else you want to know during PCN?
Any bleeding, sir? Any bleeding from the PCN tube?
Okay, bleeding, but that's not so important. Anything else?
Any stones getting stuck into the PCN or any
stones coming from
the PCN tube?
No, stones will never come out through PCN. Krishnendu?
Sir, I would also like to see how with how much pressure the fluid is coming out. After puncture, the fluid comes out with force. That means probably it's a relatively newer obstruction. But if there is a scanty fluid coming out in a less force, then probably it's a long-standing obstruction.
Yes, I think this is a very, very valid point. And all of you remember that whenever you are doing PCN, see, when we ask a candidate that you describe how you do PCN, these are the points which we expect that you will tell. That how you will take the puncture, whether you will collect fluid for culture, and then whether the fluid is coming under pressure or not. Because if it is a high pressure, as you rightly pointed out, the implications are different. Because now your whole thinking is from the point of view of how this kidney is going to recover, whether it is likely to recover or not, and if it is going to recover, how it will recover. Okay, so that is very important. All right, so in this patient, the PCN was done, and PCN was done. It was a turbid fluid, but nephrostomy was put, and it was under low pressure. 14 French Mallinckrodt catheter was kept, and then subsequently, patient was shifted to the ward. Now, Venkat,
yes, sir.
You have done PCN. Patient was stabilized. It's with a session of HD and the turbid fluid has come in. It was not under pressure. So now in a post-operative period, what are the things which you will observe?
Sir, I would like to keep the patient in observation considering his vital parameters in view of tachycardia,
okay, hypotension. So you want to see for tachycardia. You want to see for any hypotension.
Hypotension and okay. Any fever.
Correct, fever. Okay.
And his output. How much is the quantity and what is the nature of the output? over a period of time, gradually, is it any hematuria or is it any clear purulent or is it cleared out? So I would these are the things I would like to monitor, sir.
Okay, so this is what you will do in the immediate post-op period. Okay, now subsequently, suppose he has done, you have in the morning you have done all these things, evening you have gone there, nephrostomy is doing now very clear urine, it is more or less cleared, and since morning to evening there is a 300 ml urine has come in, and per urethral 500 ml urine has come in last 12 hours. So now what is your feeling?
So
Vaibhav, now tell me what are the things which you will observe in next 2, 3, 4, 5, 7 days?
Sir, next 2-3 days I would like to observe his urine output, his serum creat, his serum potassium and serum sodium levels.
Okay.
So I'd like to serially monitor his serum creat for next 2-3 days.
Okay.
Whether it's dropping down or not, sir.
Okay.
And thereafter, I'd like to repeat the serum. If it's coming down, thereafter, I'd like to check the serum creat after 7 days.
Okay. So, first creatine you will do next day?
Yeah.
Okay.
So, I'd like to repeat the serum creat for next 2-3 days, sir.
All right. Okay. So, it is good idea to check about the output, how it is coming. Okay, so let me give you a situation that you have done PCN today and the patient is stabilized. His creatinine in pre-op after HD was 6.4 and 3 days are over. His output from left PCN is 500 ml. From the peripheral is 1 liter and his PCA and his creatinine from 6 has come down to 4.2 in 3 days time. So what do you think now? 3 days are over. He's feeling much better and he's quite happy with whatever you have done. He says, now I'm feeling far better. And so what is they are asking now, sir, what next? Tell us.
Okay. Sir, next I'd still like to wait for the serum creat to come down, sir. Or I'll just like to observe his serum creat and his urine output.
Okay.
And I'd like to find out the nadir serum creat value, sir.
So what do you mean by nadir creat?
Nadir serum creat value is the value which for at least 2 readings should be same after a certain following period of time after the PCN, sir.
Okay, right. Venkat, do you agree with him?
Sir, 2-3 points which I like to add. I would like to wait for the nadir creatinine, that is for sure. And the nadir creatinine will be the lowest possible creatinine without support of dialysis and a constant value for 2 or 3 readings. That is after 2 weeks period, sir. And even before that time, I would like to discharge the patient with removal of catheter and also ask him to note the PCN output every day, either 12 hourly or 24 hourly, to know about it and also the periurethral output, sir. And
when will you call him?
I will call him after 2 weeks, sir.
After 2 weeks directly. So you don't want to see in between?
I would like to report the creatinine after 7 days. So in between,
don't leave such patients. See, his creatinine on third day is 4.5.
Yes.
Now don't just leave him and say, so now I don't want to see you, because it doesn't mean that it will not increase further. 4.5 is still a very borderline creatinine.
Yes,
it has decreased in 3 days. Doesn't mean that it will keep on increasing. It may increase also. Why it will increase?
PCN block.
Krishnan, you tell me, suppose third day creatinine is 4.5.
Yes, sir.
And is it possible that now it will increase further?
Yes, sir, it is possible. I want to make sure 2 things. Another, in the post-operative period, I also want to do a bedside sonography to see whether the system is collapsing or not. There may be which is not collapsing. So that gives a possibility that further creat may come down if that part is decompressed. Number two, sir, post-operative on second or third day, the creat may rise because of pre-renal cause like hypotension, there may be a cause of rise of creatinine. Number two, infection, and if broad spectrum antibiotic is not properly covered, then that can cause a rise of serum creatinine, and there may be a clog into the PCN tube that may cause decreased output, and that can also cause rise of creatinine. So serial monitoring output and sonography.
Right. I think these are the important points that you, if there is a rise in creatinine, blockage and fever and all these things can cause increase in the creatinine. So these things have to be checked. After this, does not mean that everything is fine and he is left alone like that. You have to see him every alternate day to ensure that his output, everything is proper. His creatinine is on the decreasing trend. Okay. All right, so now let me give you a scenario that this patient was doing quite okay. His third day, his creatinine was 4.8. And then he was discharged, he was staying outside. He's coming regularly. And he has come now after 2 weeks are over, everything was fine. He's still on the nephrostomy. He's passing good amount of urine, about 1.5 liters from urethra. And his output from the nephrostomy is about 800 to 900. But his creatinine now is still 4. 2 weeks are over, his creatinine is 4. So now, Vaibhav,
yes, sir.
Tell me, what will you do? 2 weeks are over, creatinine pre-op was 6. Now it has come to 4. His output is 900 from nephrostomy and 1.5 liters from urethra.
Sir, as the PCN is and the urethral output is quite good, sir, for this patient. And after the 2 weeks of follow-up, after his creat from 4.6, it just reduced very slightly from 4.6 to 4. So probably this would be his nadir creat level at this point. And still, I'd like to wait for some time, and I'd like to repeat his creat, sir, at this time.
Okay. Now, what have you done and what have you thought of the right side? Is it just given up? And from this peripheral output is coming from where?
So from the same kidney and from as well as from the other kidney, sir.
So what do you want to do? Anything on the right side or nothing? Just leave alone. Nothing is to be done.
Sir, nothing right now for the right side. Right now.
Why you don't?
Because he's having a lower pole stone. And the left kidney is not having any hydronephrosis, sir.
Okay, right.
So, and he's asymptomatic on the right side, sir.
That call you have to take whether it will be, whether to do anything or not. Now, Venkat,
yes, sir.
You tell me, he has said that 2 weeks are over. Creatinine is from 4.8, which was there on third day. At 2 weeks, it is decreased to 4. So, would you like to still observe or you will do something else?
Sir, I would like to wait for 1 or 2 weeks more in view of repeating the creatinine once. And in between, I would like to investigate and make the patient fit for surgery, which I am planning to do. Because his creatinine is at 4 or it might come below it. So,
investigations do you want to do?
Investigation for pre-anesthetic fitness, sir. Not a definitive thing.
So that's okay. So forget that. Anything else you want to do for the for this kidney?
Sir, I would like to do a functional study at this point of time. Because for the left kidney, I know the urine output. I can calculate with the UV by P formula. But for the right kidney, it is a periurethral output. The output can be some from the left kidney and some from the right kidney. I am not sure. So, in
so
view of
how
that,
will you, if you are saying that some urine is going down, then how will you calculate the formula? It is a fallacious result, isn't it?
Fallacious.
Yes, sir. So I would like to do a functional study in the form of EC scan for this.
You want to do functional study?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Why you want to do functional study?
To actually address the functional status of both the kidneys, sir, which is a better functioning kidney and which is a poorly functioning kidney, and okay, subsequent to plan the surgery on which side to be first or which side to be second. And so
all
these
right.
are my...
Vaibhav, do yes, you sir. Agree with his plan or you have a different plan?
Sir, I'd like to wait for 2 weeks and I'd like to do a functional study after 4 weeks, sir. I'd like to, I agree with Venkat, sir, with a functional study to be done, sir.
So you also want to do functional study?
Yeah.
Right. Okay. So Krishnendu, suppose yes, you are given option, you agree with other two people?
Sir, considering the fact that on third day create was 4.2, on the 2 week create was 4, so these two values have not changed much. So likely that this is 4 is the baseline creatinine of the patient in this situation. So, and the patient is afebrile, patient is otherwise having no problem. So further waiting, I am not justified, but I will go with a functional study to see most importantly whether the left kidney is at all functioning, so that we will go for stone removal, or considering the thin kidney, whether nephrectomy would be a better option. This is what I am thinking, sir.
No, but you see, 900 cc per day output is coming from left side. So you are considering nephrectomy on this side?
Sir, the justification is that the patient already has a thin parenchyma. Patient has a past history of stone, and now patient also had stone. The this type of non-functioning kidney may be a source of infection. Even patient eventually is going into a chronic renal failure state. But if there is persistent non-functioning kidney,
but source of infection is there. Now there is a stone, which is obvious, yes, source, sir, of infection, which is there on the other side also.
The other side has to be removed.
So would you like to remove the source of infection, or you want to remove the kidney?
For the right side, I will remove the stone. For the left side, I will see whether the stone removal is justified, or removing the stone only, keeping a kidney which is vulnerable to subsequent infection in future, is justified or not. So I will see the renogram.
Okay. Okay. So that is your justification of doing the functional study by the isotope study. All right. Now, Vaibhav.
Yes, sir.
You want to do functional study. What is your reason of doing functional study?
Sir, I'll get an information which is the better functioning kidney, sir.
Why you want that information?
Yes, sir.
Why you want that information?
Sir, the better functioning kidney, I'd like to operate it first, sir. Just to preserve the function, sir.
No, better operating function, you want to operate first means what?
You have put PCN.
Suppose on the scan, the right side shows 60% function and left side is 40%. So you want do right side surgery first.
Sir, the voice was not clear, sir.
No, suppose the scan shows that it is the right side kidney is contributing 60% and left is contributing 40%. He's on the left side PCN. So because it is showing more function, you want to do right side stone clearance first.
Actually, sir, in this patient, this patient was symptomatic on the left side, and the left side stone is obstructing, sir.
Yes. So
I'd like to do on the left side, but it will give me an information regarding the quantitative functions of the both sides.
No, that is what I want to know, that why you want that information. What's the logic of having that information?
It would help me to explain the patient as well, sir.
What
regarding the overall kidney function of the patient, sir?
The overall kidney function as such, if after decompression, after waiting for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, if creatinine is 4, it is not coming down, the subsequent consecutive readings are 4, it is enough justification to explain everything. No? Why is this scan to be done, and then you want to explain to the patient? What is this going to add anything?
Medico-legal aspects, if nephrectomy done, it is one point which can be added, sir, at this point of time.
Medico-legal.
If nephrectomy has been done with only 1 ml or non-functioning kidney status, so removing kidney might be a medico-legal issue.
Are you planning to remove the kidney?
No, sir. The aspect of functional status, which I am adding a point just to justify that.
No, that is not a justification at all. At this point of time, there is no logic of doing any functional study. There is no justification. Even if you say, even if the other side kidney shows 15%, either left side is showing more function or right side showing more and left side less, you are not going to remove any kidney because you don't know how much it is. Overall, both kidneys are contributing less because overall creatinine is 4. So you understand this point is very important because this will keep coming all the time. Whenever this problem will come, when you have the creatinine which is borderline and you have one kidney which is disproportionately bad and it is forming a source of infection. Suppose you have removed this stone, okay, you have removed both the stones, or and there is a persistent left side pain and fever and this, then it is justified that you want to do EC scan and find out the kidney which is causing a lot of trouble, how much it is functioning, and then you can take a decision whether to remove that kidney or not, you see. But when you have put PCN, urine is clear, you have a source which you can remove, once the stones are removed, then you have to assess how this function or how this kidney is behaving. It is also possible that this kidney will not have any problem. Its pain will go away, fever will go away, everything is, it is all right. It is also possible that the other side stone also may come up with infection. So in a borderline case, I don't think there is any enough justification for you to do a functional assessment on both sides. So this point you need to remember, okay? All right, so now he came with this turbid urine, you have put up PCN on the left side and you want to treat this stone. All of you agree that left side stone requires to be removed. I don't think there is any dispute.
Yes,
and you already have a PCN. So the PCNL is the answer. Is that correct?
Yes, yes, sir.
All right. Okay, so now you tell me, Krishnendu,
yes,
that
sir.
The PCN tract is already there, right? Now you want to do PCNL in a patient who has got a 4 creatinine. What are the problems you anticipate? What are the complications? And what precautions you will take?
So number one, these patients may have pallor. As we have seen, hemoglobin is 9. So if interpretably there is any bleeding, then suddenly the hemoglobin can fall suddenly. Number two, right. These patients come to infection. And already I have seen the culture is E. coli. So prior to surgery, I will start at least 3 days prior to IV antibiotic. Number right. three, these patients may prone to have coagulation disorder. So I will recheck the coagulation profile again.
Number okay, three, agreed. What else?
Because these patients have a poorly functioning kidney, so if there is a volume overload, the patient on the suddenly may have acute requirement of dialysis. Volume status has to be assessed with a nephrologist. Number three,
okay, these, good. What else?
These patients are prone to also to have cardiac comorbidities. So I would like right. to have with a cardiologist, even if there is no cardiac issue. And so these are the things I will anticipate preoperative. So
apart from what he has said, anybody wants to add anything? Venkat, Vaibhav, anything you want to add apart from what he has said? Or you have nothing to add? There is one very important point, which is very, very important.
The calcium and the uric acid may be high.
No, that's okay. That's okay. We are talking of the surgery. What is important? What you say is that you want to do not want to overload. So preoperatively in a patient like this, it is good idea to do central venous line so that you can monitor the patient properly, whether there is any overload or whether there is dehydration. Either way is bad. It is not proper to give less fluid. It is not proper to give more fluid. So central venous line, EVP will give you the idea how much output you want to give, how much input you want to give. Okay. If the tract is already present, you can go with that tract. There is no problem. And you can take out the single stone. You can take out this. There is a small lower calcium stone. You want to take out this. Okay. So you have removed the stone through the existing tract. It was a very fragile sort of a stone, and your tract was quite good. Lower calyx stone also you have removed. Now, will you keep a nephrostomy? Will you keep a digestent, or you want to do a tubeless procedure? Vaibhav, what is your idea?
Sir, I'd like to assess this intra-op, whether this procedure is going well, whether there is any intra-op hemorrhage is hampering.
You have done a great job. Absolutely no problem. You have finished this stone 3 cm in half an hour's time. It was a very soft, fragile stone.
In this case, I'd like to put an PCN as well as a degestant for this patient, sir. Because this was already an infected system. The patient had already had complications. So I don't want to take any further risk of any fever. So I want this kidney to be draining very well, sir.
Okay. Venkat, you agree?
Yes, sir. I would like to keep degestant and also nephrostomy in this case, in keeping in view the high risk of the patient. And also, maybe some small fragments might go into the ureter. I don't want any ureteric obstruction. Or there might be PUJ edema. I don't want any obstructive features postoperatively, and also the nephrostomy to drain any residual fragments or any clots. So I will
But you see, you have cleared the stone completely. The procedure went off very well. Even lower calyx stone you have cleared. You are quite sure that there is no stone left over. You are going to keep nephrostomy. I agree with you that this is the high risk case. You want to keep a nephrostomy. But yes. Why you want to keep a degestant? Because in addition to that, now you have to subsequently take out the degestant. Why is all that? Why not keep nephrostomy? Every patient of 3 cm stone, you don't, if it is a straightforward surgery, you don't keep a degestant. What is something special in this case that you want to put a DG? VG and nephrostomy both.
There might be PUJ edema.
No, there is no edema. It's already 4 weeks. The drainage is already there. It's a mature tract. Intraoperative, no bleeding, nothing.
There might be some fragments which might be entering the ureter. Small fragments which might not have been noticed.
No, but you are keeping nephrostomy for that as a safety. You can always clamp it and take it out. Any justification, Vaibo?
Sir, this kidney is already compromised, sir. The urine output was okay, but after removal of PCN tube, I would like to make sure that the kidney is draining well for further some more amount of time, sir. So yes. After removal of the PCN tube, there won't be any other safety measures for the kidney to drain well, sir. That's why I'd like to keep an degestant as well, sir.
Right. Okay, so justification, I agree with all of you that degestant is absolutely necessary. The reason, there are 2-3 reasons. What are the reasons? First is that this tract of PCNL was quite a long time tract. You know, so 4 weeks tract, you have gone through the same tract. So if you don't keep any degestant, it is possible that this tract may not close down very fast. And it may persist to have the urinary leak from the site. That is one. Secondly, as you have seen, the shape of the kidney in a pre-operative CT scan was such that it's a very irregular parenchyma, very irregular dilatation, came with turbid urine. So these are the kidneys, which are small contracted kidneys, and they don't tend to collapse in the way you want to that kidney to collapse. And therefore, even after removal of nephrostomy, it is possible that some amount of hydronephrosis, especially in the pockets, may remain, and that may be the source of infection. And therefore, to overcome this problem for the smooth collapsing of the kidney, to effective drainage of the kidney, and to allow the healing of the tract very fast, you would like to keep a degestant. Okay. So all that is done, degestant is kept, everything is fine. Patient is discharged, he comes for follow-up after 1 month for DJ removal, and that time he is completely asymptomatic. His creatinine has dropped down further to 3.2 now. He was discharged at 4, and after one more month he has come for DJ removal, his creatinine is 3.2. So now what will you do for the right side? He is asking what should I do for the right side.
Sir, I would like to also remove the right side stone because presence of stone may be a source of infection. My planning will be because it is in the lower calyx and almost 1 cm stone. So my planning will be to retrograde internal surgery in this patient to remove that stone.
No, but why? why do you assume that this stone will also get infected? Yes, it has not got infected. This is not formed stone which is formed today. It must have been formed for 6 months, maybe 1 year. So why you want to treat this stone in anticipation that this will cause infection? If it causes infection, you can always treat it. Where is the problem?
Sir, in a patient with already compromised renal function, if there is a persistent source of infection that can hasten the process of renal deterioration, number one. Number two, if we see the CT scan.
Suppose I tell you that you have removed the digestion, you have called for follow-up, he wants to come later, he has come for follow-up, his urine routine microscopic is not showing any pyuria, his culture is sterile. He has no pain, no nothing, count is normal, everything is fine. Now 3 months from the surgeries are over, his culture is sterile, creatinine is 3.2. Why you want to remove the right side? Venkat, will you remove this right side stone?
Yes, sir, I would have removed
the right side. Or you will keep under observation?
No, sir, I would have removed the stone.
What is your justification? See, now 3 months are over from the left side PCNL. Everything is fine. He is completely asymptomatic. His urine culture is sterile. So now, do you want to intervene in this?
Yes, sir. I would like to intervene even in this case with a 1 centimeter calculus in the lower calyx, keeping in view that the stone might be a cause of the infection later on in his life because patient is young, 45 years old. The second thing is it might change its position. It might come to UPJ and it might cause obstruction, sir. Second point, which I might consider for the treatment. These are, and he's a poorly functioning kidney. So I would like to.
So now my question to you is that suppose this patient is not willing for surgery at present. You advise that whatever reason you have given, I agree that there is an infection possible. This. And you know he has not gone for follow-up even previously after that surgery, he went only twice. And he says, no, what, I'm not interested now, but I'll come afterwards. So he has some problem. Now he comes after 1 year. Okay, he is still perfectly all right. He has come and to his great luck, his creatinine also is now come down from 3.2 to 2.6. And he never had any infection in this. He's quite happy. He has good output. He's doing all his whatever work he's doing. Now, will you advise him surgery?
Sir, now
your justification remains same.
No, I would like to see the status of the stone, sir. Now, over this 1 year,
It is almost the same. It is a lower calyceal 1 centimeter stone.
Sir, the natural history of a stone is that 50% of the stone will be symptomatic. Even if the stones which are not symptomatic nowadays, 30% of them will have over a 5 year period have some symptoms. And overall, stone will have some infection. So considering this.
So your idea is that a natural history of any stone, if you observe for next 5 years or 10 years, if you observe any stone, asymptomatic for 10 years, 80% of them will become symptomatic. So that is your justification, right? Any other justification from anyone?
Plus, in the
all of you agree that stone to be removed? All of you agree with the stone to be removed?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so give me justification.
Sir, my justification would be like this patient had already had a rough course. So I don't want to take any risk compromising any of his renal functions, sir, even henceforth, sir. So that's why now the patient is stable and I'd like to go with the stone removal on the right side, sir.
Because, is it possible that you have taken up for the RIRS? I think RIRS is everybody's choice. Is that right?
No, sir. No. RIRS in this lower calyceal calculus, there are problems even with the RIRS scope there, considering the...
So your choice is PCNL?
No, sir. To start with RIRS only, if it fails, I would like to do the other mini PCNL at the same instance.
Okay.
I would
Perfect. I agree. Totally agree. Yes. Suppose you take up this patient for RIRS.
Yes.
It's quite easy to go in the stone. I mean, the angle is quite favorable and you finish RIRS. And now it lands up with severe infection. Post-op, he has got a fever. Post-op, he has got sepsis. And his creatinine has jumped to 4. now what will you do now? Are you not stuck that you have taken our patient whose creatinine was 2.8, 2.6, you have done RIRS, and now he has landed up with the sepsis?
Yes, sir. It is an anticipated complication in RIRS in a high-risk case, considering the CKD status and also
So what I want to ask you is that when you say that there is a chance of this potentially becoming infection symptomatic, maybe 5 years, 10 years down the line, but by then his creatinine may jump up and he may be the case for RRT. So why you want to hurry up and take out this stone now?
Yes, sir. I will consider this observation.
So now you want to observe. Now all of you want to observe. You want to change. No, that's not right. You see. So now, the decision. See, you have to consider that why this patient has remained asymptomatic in spite of stone. That is one. Secondly, even after 1 year, why this stone has not increased in the size? On the CT scan, it is seen. Creatinine has dropped from 9 to 6 to 4 to this and now 2.6. All right. So now this is a time to see how much is the contribution of this kidney. All of you are jumping to this EC scan and other things. Now this is a time in a CKD when you want to assess, especially in a situation like this where your everything is precarious. Now is the time to do EC scan and find out how much is really contribution of this kidney. Because if it is contributing only 10-15%, you don't want to intervene. In case of there is any problem, you can explain to the patient, this is not contributing much, I would straight away do nephrectomy. But if he is remaining asymptomatic, let it contribute 10-15%, whatever function it is contributing. Okay. And because it is usually non-functioning kidneys are asymptomatic. Usually, non-functioning kidneys, the stone will not increase in size. Usually, if the creatinine is coming down by intervention on one side, usually that is a solitary functioning kidney. Okay. So, all these factors should be considered and then the decision of the right side is to be taken. Right? So, these are all things we have discussed a lot. I think these are the points which always come in the exam. Especially one side kidney is functioning, other side kidney is non-functioning, bilateral stone. So I think all of you have answered quite well. I'm quite happy with the way you have answered and where you have justified. So thank you very much. And I'm sure these sort of sessions are helpful to all of you and all those who are actually watching this discussion.
So thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
All right. Okay. Bye. Thank you.